I'm Matthew Vandan, senior scientist working in the gene bank in Kristat, India. I'm working on sorghum, pearl millet, and small millets, germplasm resources on different activities that enhances the use of germplasm in crop improvement. Now I will be talking about strategies for identification of promising germplasm in the ex situ gene bank collection. So outline of the presentation will be: what is global challenges to agriculture? What is plant genetic resources? And what about the global status of plant genetic resources? And then CGR collection. Then we will be discussing about gene bank and its activities. Then we'll go to the strategies for identification of promising germplasm. So before I go to this topic, so I'd like to tell about challenges to global agriculture. As we know, the decreasing land and water available for agriculture because of this heavy industrialization and human activities. And we need to feed about 9.8 billion by 2050. The current population is 7.7 billion and India is in second in place in the face of global warming climate changes. So the multiple impact of global warming includes altered precipitation, pest and diseases, incidences, drought and heat waves, freshwater decline for irrigation, biodiversity loss, desertification and land degradation. These are all some of the multiple impacts of global warming and climate changes. It will affect the global agriculture. What is the solution is developing climate resilient technologies together with judicious management of natural resources is the way forward to address this food and nutritional security in the changing climate. So here, plant genetic resources play a significant role. What is plant genetic resources? Any materials of plant origin, including reproductive, vegetative propagating materials containing functional unit of heredity of plants. So this is called plant genetic resources. So plant genetic resources contribute to sustainable development goals of to end poverty and hunger, combat climate change and its impacts, and also SDG 15 by halting the loss of crop biodiversity. There are two types of plant genetic resources conservation. One is in situ conservation and another one is ex situ conservation. In the in situ conservations, plant germplasms or plant genetic resources are conserved under the natural habitat or protected areas. This includes natural parks, biosphere reserves, on-farm conservation, and more. And the ex situ conservations is conservation of plant genetic resources, germplasm, outside its natural habitats. It includes seed bank, conservation of seeds in the gene controlled environment condition, conservation of plant in the field itself, in vitro conservation, and DNA bank. These are all the ex situ conservations. So coming to the gene bank, what is the gene bank? Gene bank is the place where these germplasm plant genetic resources are conserved ex situ. The important activity is conserve and distribute plant genetic resources for research, education, breeding purposes following standard material transfer agreement. Important activities includes germplasm collection, then conservation of the collected germplasm under medium-term storage condition and long-term storage conditions, and characterization of these conserved germplasm for morphoagronomic and heritable traits following the descriptors of respective crops, and evaluation of the germplasm for important traits so that this germplasm will be used in the crop improvement program. Distribution is important activity. We distribute the germplasm globally for research, education and breeding purposes, and then safety duplication. These are all the important activities of gene bank. So if coming to the global status of plant genetic resources, there are about 7.4 million accessions are there globally conserved in the gene banks. About 10% of them will be mostly crop wild relatives, and 11% of the total germplasm is in the CGR gene bank. So here this map shows the distribution of CGR gene banks, CGR Institute and their gene banks. So here, CGR Institute wise, the number of germplasm conserved in their gene banks are listed here. For example, Attic Research, about 128,000 germplasm accessions are there, including chickpea, groundnut, pigeon pea, pearl millet, small millets, and sorghum. From 2007 to 2016, this CGR gene bank distributed about 39 lakhs seed samples to so many countries. So at ICRISAR gene bank, we have about 128,000 germplasm accessions of 6 mandate crops as well as 5 small millets originating from 144 countries. As of now, the gene banks distributed about 1.5 million seed samples to 148 countries. And this germplasm also safely duplicated at Svalbard Global Seed Vault, Norway. This is the, already I mentioned, this is the status of germplasm at ICRISAR gene bank. We have a large number of germplasm in most crops and in most gene bank. Then how to enhance the use of germplasm in crop improvement? There is low use of germplasm in crop improvement is reported in many crops. To enhance the use of germplasm, we need to have information about the accession for important traits. But in most crops and most accessions, less or no information on trait of importance is there. Therefore, we need to evaluate them. Is it possible to evaluate the entire collection? This is a big question and it is very difficult. And time consuming, resource consuming, and efficiency will be low. Then, how to mine the entire germplasm to identify promising sources? So this is the big question that we need to answer. We will be answering in the next slides. The strategies for identification of promising germplasm from large existing collections. There are three strategies. First one is development of germplasm representative subsets, such as core and mid-core collection. Second one is focused identification of germplasm strategy. And then third one is allele mining using genomic approaches. Coming to the first approach, development of germplasm representative subset. When we have large number of accessions in thousands, it is difficult for effective and efficient evaluation of traits to identify promising sources. Therefore, we need to have small number of germplasm that represent the entire collection. So in 1984, Frankel proposed a concept called the core collection, which is 10% of the entire collection. The core collection, the definition is represent with a minimum of repetitiveness the genetic diversity of a crop species and its wide relatives. Which data you can use for development of core collection? The available data such as passport and characterization data, taxonomical data, geographical information, molecular data, all this data you can use for development of core collection. Does it help our purpose to identify promising sources? Definitely it is yes, when the size of core collection is small, when it is manageable in number. But the size of core collection is large, then again, the purpose will not solve. Therefore, we need to have a subset still smaller in size. What is the remedy is mini core collection. The mini core collection was proposed in 2001 by Dr. Upadhyaya and Hortis. It is 10% of the core collection, 1% of the entire collection. This flowchart shows development of core collection and then mini core collection. First, this is the entire collection. So we will be having characterization and evaluation phosphatic data of the entire germplasm. Using that, such as the taxonomic, morphological, and geographical data, we need to group them, the large number of germplasm, into small groups based on a taxonomy or morphology or any geographic data. So we need to group them. We need to group them into how many groups are there, we need to group them. Then using the passport and characterization data, we need to do some diversity distance analysis and then do clustering. After clustering, we need to choose 10% of accession from each clusters, from each groups. Then it will constitute core collection. This core collection, once we developed, we need to compare the core collection with the entire collection in terms of mean, range, variance, and other statistics, so that the core collection what we developed should represent the entire collection. Once the core collection is developed and it is small in size, then we can use that core collection for multi-location evaluation for identification of promising sources. But in some cases, the core collections are large. For example, in sorghum, increased sorghum collection, the core collection is more than 2,000 accession. This 2,000 is very difficult for any characterization or evaluation. Therefore, we developed a mini core collection, that is core of core. So after developing core collection, you can evaluate this core collection for morphoagronomic traits or any other traits, then do follow the same approach to develop what we used for the development of core collection. We can follow the same approach using that evaluation data to form the mini core collection. After developing the mini core collection, we can use that mini core collection for evaluation. Is there any software to develop core collection or mini core collection? Yes, there are some softwares. Yeah, window based softwares are there, like PowerCore or MSDot, and R language based packages are there, like GenoCore, Core Hunter, CC Core. By following this core collection approach, we have developed core collections for all our increased mandate crops, including small millets. The highest one is 2,247 accession in sorghum, and the lowest one is in little millet, 56 accession. And then, since the number of accession in the core collection is large in these increased mandate crops, what we did, we have developed a mini core collection. Mini core collection, you can see the number of accession is, the largest one is 242 accession in sorghum, and then smallest one is in foxtail millet. It is small in number and it is manageable in number, so this can be evaluated in multiple location and with multi replications. So once we developed a core and mini core collection, the next step is we need to identify promising sources from the core collection. So following this core and mini core collection approaches, once we developed this, we have evaluated this core and mini core collection for different traits of importance, like biotic stresses, abiotic stresses, agronomic traits, and the nutritional traits. Then we have identified important sources, promising sources for these traits. In chickpea, this is example in chickpea. And also we have identified some gem blossom accession which are sources for multiple traits, and also in agronomically good background. So this gem blossom can be utilized effectively in crop improvement program for enhancing multiple traits. In groundnut also, we have identified gem blossom, promising gem blossom sources for abiotic stress, biotic stresses, quality traits, agronomics, as well as multiple trait sources. Similarly, we have identified multi-trait specific sources with agronomically high yielding background. And in sorghum also, we have evaluated this sorghum mini core collection for different traits, and then we identified multi-trait specific sources and with agronomically high yielding. The next one is focused identification of gem blossom strategy. This strategy was proposed or developed at International Center for Agriculture Research in the dry area, Ecuador, to identify subset of accession with a high probability of containing specific target traits based on the eco-geographical information of the sites where the populations were collected. So all of us know the environment strongly influences natural selection. Therefore, it increases the chances of finding adaptive traits of interest in that particular environment or area. This focus approach matches plant traits with geographic and agroclimatic information of the places where the gem blossom accessions are collected. There are two approaches are there in the fix. One is filtering approach, another one is modeling approach. The filtering approach, what we need to know is we need to have deep understanding of the ecology and the optimal conditions of expression of the particular traits of interest, what we are looking for. Then the filtering will be applied. Filters will be applied during the search process, considering this geographic location, climate conditions, and long-term climate and soil characteristics. All these traits will be used to well search process to filter out from a large collection to a small number. Next one is modeling approach. When we have some data, evaluation data, then we can use that data and then we can explore the mathematical relationship between the adaptive traits and then long-term climate or soil characteristics. We can model that traits and then along with the climate and soil characteristics in the modeling approach. For example, in wheat, for identification of fixed subset for sun-pest in wheat, this fixed approach was followed. The starting material was over 16,000 accession, and then after filtering, they came to 534 accessions, following several filtering filters. First, they filtered materials that were collected between 30 to 45 latitude and 35 to 80 longitude. Further, they excluded accession from China, Pakistan and India, because there are only few reports are available in these countries about this pest. Finally, after these two filters, they came down to 6,328 accession. Next filter was excluding accessions collected from dry environment, because rainfall below 280 mm per year, this dry environment does not favor the sun pest. The next filter was excluding sites where winter temperature fall below 10 degree, because this winter temperature below 10 degree does not favor this pest. Finally, after filtering these four or five criteria, they got 534 accession. This is called fix subset. This fix subset was used to evaluate for this sun pest, and then they have identified 9 accession as sources for this sun pest. Instead of the evaluating the 16,000 accessions. So this enhances the probability of obtaining the specific traits. There are many other studies out there using this focused identification approach in wheat, barley and faba bean for biotic abiotic stresses. What is the difference between core and fixed approach? In the core approach, the germplasm that we are obtaining represent the diversity of the entire collection. But in the fixed approach, that germplasm will not represent the entire diversity. So this fixed approach was developed for a specific traits, but the core and mini core collections are developed and that can be used to identify any multiple traits. Here, probability of obtaining the desirable traits is high, because this subset, fixed subset, was developed considering the specific traits. But here in the core and mini core approach, probability of obtaining the specific traits is very low. Core collection accessions are diverse, but the fixed accession in the fix are less diverse because it is based on the specific environment. The third one is allele mining using genomic approaches. This next advances in next generation genomics will help in gene bank operation to study the diversity of the germplasm and to study the population structure and also to identify the duplicates and for the genome-wide association mapping, allele mining, characterization and allele mining, and also for help us in studying the appropriate sample size and all. Coming to the allele mining using genomic approach, this next generation genomics platform and availability of genome sequences, high throughput genotyping platforms as well as phenotyping platforms. It will support in allele mining. This allele mining will help us in discovering superior alleles, development of allele specific markers, and identification of new haplotypes and other studies like evolution study. So the first approach in this GS is this genomic approach is association mapping. There are two types of association mappings are there. One is genome-wide association mapping and another one is candidate gene-based association mapping. For doing this association mapping approach, we need to have an association mapping panel, and then we need to have the phenotypic data of our interest and then genotypic data. And using this association mapping approach, there are many studies in different crops. They have used this approach to identify trait-specific sources for biotic abiotic stresses, quality traits, and more. And coming to the ecotilling and gene-based sequencing approach, this ecotilling approach looks for natural mutations in individuals, while in the tilling approach we create the mutation using mutagens and then look for the variations. Using this tilling and using this ecotilling and gene based approaches, there were many studies were done for different traits in rice, beet, barley, sugar beet, and potato for different traits, and they have discovered novel SNPs and genes using this approach. Coming to the last approach is genomic prediction. This genomic predictions uses genome-wide markers to predict genomic breeding value. For this, what we need to have training population, and we need to have genotypic and phenotypic information of that training population. Using that genotypic and phenotypic information, we need to develop a model, GS model, and then we can use that model in remaining collections with using only genotypic information. There are many studies out there in genomic prediction or in the gene bank collections. In conclusion, germplasm is basic to crop improvement that everyone knows. Considering crop diversity is the first and foremost crucial steps to ensure food and nutritional security, and there is large variability in the germplasm for important traits. What we need to do is we need to use appropriate strategies for mining novel variation and their utilization in crop improvement. Thank you very much.